Ra leboga joko ya hawe popebe e khatulula tumelo na kitebe
tumelo
na kitebe e tampe Nyakalo ke fumane tselenya amor dira hona dikalane Ke le la le ke tsepe
le hoti
moeti ha khatale o pe jwa
ke modi
ke sale tatile fela ki duti jwale
e sale
hon tati umpodisite matswalo me jwale ta ho tla ba jwang ha ke sia Hallelujah, Hosanna, Sekenya Hoje, Hotabajwang Hakisia, Kuboe.
Go bahare ka ema tswetswe ja ka ra mogela mo premier le vice chancellor ya university ba gaitso ka tswetswe ra le bogale ka nna le nna mo fatshe Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let me first start by introducing myself. My name is Christopher Motabuchi. I'm manager corporate communication for the Northwest University within the corporate relations and marketing department. It is my duty today to officiate as master of ceremonies in the place of my executive director, Mr. Clement Manuku, who could not make it due to a family bereavement. Allow me to please first welcome the Northwest University Principal and Vice Chancellor, Prof. Mzubanzi Bismarck Jobeka, the Premier of the Northwest Province, Rebushimape, our host, Professor Sonia Swanepoel, the DVC, Community Engagement and Mahikeng Campus Operations, members of the University Management Council, the Deanery, academic and support staff of the university, dignitaries from other higher education institutions, and political leaders in attendance, community members, and members from the media fraternity. But last but not least, we also would like to extend a warm welcome to the family and friends of the late Professor Ntate Dan Kwadi. Before we start with the proceedings, I would like to make one or two announcements in terms of housekeeping. We really would like to ask you to please limit movement in and out of the hall. Since we are already about 30 minutes late, we had initially planned to start at 11 o'clock, but we are on 11:30 at the moment. But should you need to make use of the ablution facilities or the toilets, for the ladies, it would be to your left, out of the hall, to your left. And for the gentlemen, it would be to your right. At this time, without wasting any time, I would like to call upon Pastor Malakalaka to lead us with an opening prayer. Thank you, Pastor Malakalaka.
Let us bow our heads as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of mercy. Dear Master, in that days we're about to start, tsebeletso e ra go kopa moya o halalelang me ra go mema so that you may come down and fill this room, Jehovah. Lord, we are asking you to lead the way as we'll be doing the memorial service of Professor Ntate Dan Kwadi. Jehovah, re go lebogela tshono e to go down memory lane and remember the great things that were wrought by your manservant, your child, Professor Kwadi, Jehovah. Lord, as the stories are told, as the memories are retold to each and one of us, Father, may they also bring sweet memories to the family, that you may heal their broken hearts and that you may carry them, Lord. In the book of Psalm 23, you say, even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we are not alone, Dade. Havarisiya, osantona le rona, me otlare kuka, Jehovah. Lord, we say that you may bless everyone who took their time from work, from school, from home in order to come and grace this occasion. May you bless everyone for their kindness. And Lord, we pray that all things may go according to your will and your purpose. We pray for all of this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Ra leboga Pastor Malakalaka ka go re bulela tiro ya gompieno. Bagaitso, today we meet here physically more the Great Hall here at Northwest University, as well as online to celebrate the life of Professor Dan Kwadi, a man that gave his life to serve and educate the black child in the aftermath of what was undeniably a brutal apartheid system that denied many of us of the darker hue an opportunity to excel in our chosen fields. Despite those well-documented challenges of the past, Prof. Dan was cut from a different cloth. He and his peers rose above the challenges. They pulled up their socks, they held their heads high, they stood on the shoulders of giants, they finally succeeded academically and achieved the unthinkable to lead a culturally rich institution that is the Northwest University. But just as Prof. Dan and many others like him in leadership positions thought that they had arrived. They got a rude awakening from those who were still adamant and wanted to retain the old status quo. We must never forget or be led to believe that the road that people like Prof. Dan walked was easy, or that they had the full support of those that now conveniently claim to have supported them. In leadership circles, they say the higher you go, the colder it becomes. But it is at this crucial juncture that the brilliance of Prof. Dan Kwadi became apparent for all to see, friends and foe alike. And this was through his successful implementation of the university's programs through challenging times. It was a battle of ideas, and it is a battle that he won hands down. So as we reminisce about the life and times of Prof. Dan, let us also remember the personal sacrifices that he made to ensure that the black child, myself included, enjoy the fruits of our democracy. There's a quote that I like, and I would like to share it with you. It says, and I quote, "Live that people may speak well of thee at thy grave. The just needs no memorial, for his deeds are his monument." Having said that, a memorial service is an opportunity for all of us to remember and pay homage to our dearly departed. Let me encourage you, as you remember this fallen hero, to do so in your own unique fashion. For me personally, I will remember Prof. Dan as a hard taskmaster. I've already mentioned that I work within corporate communication, and one of my key responsibilities is to work with members of the media. And the one thing that I will remember vividly about Prof. Dan is that he always used to have this penchant of calling people after hours. And it really used to get to me, because I used to say to myself, and this thing always happened whenever one started enjoying the evening, opening a cold beverage, and there was Prof wanting to know, what's the feedback? What's happening? Why haven't you done 1, 2, 3? And of course, there was also always the healthy sprinkling of Prof telling you that if this thing goes wrong, remember that your head is on the block. But of course, that made me to understand that Prof Dan indeed had the best interests of the Northwest University at heart. And he really, really loved this campus in particular. And I can say that without fear of contradiction, that he wanted only the best for us, both students and staff. So at this time, as we celebrate Prof. Dan's memory, I urge you not to fear. You might have a different story to tell from the one that I have told. You might have a different story to tell, whether sad or good. But at the end of the day, the crux of the matter is that he wanted to make sure that the Northwest University becomes a world-class university. And I believe we can all put our hands together for Prof. Dan to say that he really did achieve that with the assistance of a lot of us who worked under him. A round of applause, please. At this time, we're about to receive the sermon by Pastor Netsi Fulani. So I would like to call upon Pastor Mlungisi to do the honors. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, MC. I stand to greet you all in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. To the Kwadi family, Isaiah chapter 3, verse 10 says to us this morning, say to the righteous, it shall be well with them. And these are the words that we wish to share with you. It gives me honor and a privilege to acknowledge and welcome all the pastors that are here. Unfortunately, because of space, we could not allocate a place for you. I would like all the men and the women of God who are here to just wave their hands so that you are well welcomed from all denominations. Please, if you are here and you are a pastor, receive this as an honor and acknowledgement. Thank you so much. I also want to welcome the Trans-Orange Conference officers who are here and the directors here present. You are most welcome, pastors. Thank you so much. This morning, the man of God who will share with us the word, it is the Trans-Orange Conference president, a man of God, an expository preacher of the gospel, a prolific preacher of the gospel, Pastor Jane Echefulane. Please help me welcome him on stage. Just as he's coming forth, we are going to request the trio to come render a special song for the pastor before he shares the message. The trio from Hope, we are kindly asking you to come forth. God bless you. Amen.
It will be worth it all when we Amen. All protocol observed. I would like to also express deep condolences to the family and also to the university family. The VC and the Premier and all the dignitaries here present. And I think, yes, all protocol as well observed. Amen. For our word of comfort, I am going to ask us to come together, to go together to the book of John chapter 19, verse 30. It's found in the New Testament. It's one of the four Gospels covering the story and the times of Jesus Christ. And this is how it reads from the King James Version. When Jesus, therefore, had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Our loving Father, before your presence, we stand. And so we ask that as much as we have gone through this passage, you may take your passage in our lives. Amen. And our little caption here for the message is, "It is finished." When Jesus, therefore, had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed down his head and gave up the ghost. The statement, "It is finished," is credited to a translation of a Greek single word, tetelestai. Tetelestai is derived from the verb telio, which means to bring to an end, to complete, to accomplish, and also the noun telos, which means end, purpose, or goal. The reconstructed meaning of the concept tetelestai will therefore be end, purpose, or goal-driven accomplishment, completeness, or end, as opposed to accidental, incidental, or deviant accomplishment or completeness. It is not a secret that some of the greatest accomplishments done by people here on earth were simply a stumble of accident. But tetelestai excludes accidental accomplishments and restricts itself to purposeful ones. The other notable about Jesus' tetelestai, "It is finished," expression is its presentation in the perfect tense. According to the Britannica dictionary, perfect tense refers to a verb tense that is used to refer to an action or state that is complete or completed at the time of speaking or at a time spoken of, unquote. And in this context, it refers to the past, present, and future progressive or continuous connection in time of accomplishment or completeness. In other words, the referent of tetelestai, "It is finished," is considered finished in the past, finished in the present, and will stay finished in the future. It is a finished finish that requires no further finishing in near or distant future. In terms of positioning of the subject or referent of the tetelestai, "It is finished," it is important to note that the "it" article in the "it is finished" is expressed in the third person as an independent variable from the person affirming the substantive referent of "it." In essence, "it" suggests without equivocation that Christ had finally accomplished the course, mission, or project that he had set himself up to execute. And according to John in the book of Revelation chapter 13 verse 8, that was purposed and accomplished from the foundation of the earth. Although the concept tetelestai has been credited to Greek origin, as initially stated, it has also been found to have been a constant with equivalent meaning from the Hebrew and Latin languages as well. All three linguistic cultures, that is the Greek, the Hebrew, and the Latin, use the same word as was with the same or equivalent meaning. The implication of Jesus' expression, therefore, and deliberate choice of the word, tetelestai, it is finished, is that he intentionally and effectively sought and accomplished to address himself to the Greek literary world, the Hebrew religious audience, and the Roman political judicial world as well. In other words, in his choice of that particular terminology, tetelestai, he positioned himself to speak to the global world. The import of this audience outlook was therefore global. A fulfilled and measured life's purpose, goal, or end driven life or existence. Accomplishment of a contemplated end or purpose is often marked by autographical writings of own story with the benefit of a rear mirror. Jesus was the only person to live with a very unique end in mind. This is the only person whose life purpose was to live to die and nothing else. In the book of Genesis, he, Jesus, became the lamb whose skin was used as a covering to cover the nakedness of Adam and Eve, prefiguring his predetermined intent to die a redemptive death for men, that right from the beginning. And in the book of Exodus, he became the Passover lamb. Without his death, nobody could be saved in Egypt. And in the book of Leviticus, he became the sacrificial lamb, which was surrendered to the altar every day and reminding Christ that his purpose, when the time shall come, is to do nothing else but to die. From the writing of Isaiah, he is portrayed as a Messiah who comes to establish his rule by dying for his people instead of killing them, as many rulers and emperors have done. Daniel, talking of him, says that he shall be cut off as in being crucified in the middle of the week to confirm the covenant with many. Matthew, recounting his birth, said that his name shall be called Jesus because he shall save his people from their sins through his death. John the Baptist, seeing him passing by a day after his baptism, proclaimed of him and about him as the Lamb of God that taketh away all the sins of the world, reminding him again that lest he forget, he needs to be reminded that he had come here and his main mission, tell us, is just to die. He was simply born to live, to die. In his dying, he had to avoid the assassin or murderer's death. He needed to gather the world together to come and witness his condemnation and sentence to die by crucifixion. He chose to die during the Passover week when the whole religious world had gathered in Jerusalem. He brought the religious priests, the Judean king Herod, and the Roman chief justice and ruler into his last ball of dance of death. And in preparation for his death mission, Jesus gave his heart to seek knowledge and wisdom. Luke records the story of how Jesus was found sitting in the midst of doctors at the temple for 3 days, engaging in an academic exercise of presentation, answering, and asking them questions. And this, I hope, for most of the academics, does settle the score of whether Jesus was educated or not. The setup in which he was found was exactly during his time similar to that of defending a doctoral dissertation. And indeed, he was doing the same. So at the age of 12, Jesus earned his full doctoral colors, after which he disappeared from public stage for about 18 years. Equipped with a doctoral qualification and 18 years of postdoctoral research, he was ready to begin his 3 years journey to death. Even to die a good death, you need to be educated. And contrary to our assumption that it is easier to die than to live, this was not the case with Jesus. In the New Testament, we see his protagonist, named as the devil by the scriptures, once more losing a battle against death. Christ was arrested, abused, taunted, delivered to Pontius Pilate, who then declared him innocent but condemned him to die. And once more, the devil was determined not to let Christ die. The devil had Christ flogged 39 strokes, inflicted extreme pain on his upper back. The intention was not to kill, but to stop him from dying, because he knew that his mission was to come to die. He wanted him to give up dying and go back to heaven without dying, because the devil knew that Jesus could. When the flogging failed to achieve its intended measured outcomes, the devil took Christ to the cross, nailed his hands and feet, lifted him up on the cross, leaving his gaping wounds at the mercy of the forces of gravity to stop Christ from dying. His third attempt at stopping his death was when Christ cries that he was thirsty. The devil had what the Bible refers to as a vinegar, used as an anesthetic alcohol, given to Christ not to quench his thirst, but to benumb his brains so that in his drunken stupor, he can command him to calm down and avoid the death mission. But when Christ had spitted it out, he cried out with a loud voice and said, "It is finished," tetelestai, hanged his head and died. The devil was finished at that moment. And once more, the devil had lost the battle against the death of Christ. The impact of his death was so phenomenal that time itself was divided into before and after the death of Christ. And to date, as we name even this date, we also end it up by saying 2023, and it is not complete until we say after the death of Christ. And once he had accomplished his life telos, he could proclaim, tetelestai, it is finished. Finished in the past, finished now, and it will remain finished even in the future. A finishing that needs no further finishing. Individual accomplishment or personal tetelestai follows the same logic. Education and education, where possible, to the point of completing a PhD is important. That is how a man fills the substance of his life with substance and prepare it for death. The more one is skilled, the less it takes one to accomplish one's mission on this earth. Christ, by the way, statistically, spent 90% of his time preparing for his mission and only 10% to execute it. If you only set aside 10% of your personal preparation to execute your mission in this world, you may as well have to spend 90% of your time trying to execute it. In other words, it is so painful, It means a hard labor to get small education because you will work hard and long. And as a matter of fact, ignorance and little education is an occupational hazard. It exposes one to die hard from hard labor. Longevity, while longevity is a blessing, however, some of us live long beyond execution of our own telos, to the point that we begin to undo our own legacies. And I pray that as soon as you know that your mission has achieved the tetelestai, it is finished. Pray to God that you die, and if you don't die, die out of the stage rather than extend yourself and linger there on that stage. We do have a story of King Hezekiah, whom God became so satisfied about his 14-year record. And the Bible tells us that after 14 years of his mission and his allocated mission, God was so satisfied with his accomplishment that he sent him a messenger of disease to put him to rest. But the Bible says Hezekiah cried and requested that his life should be extended. And indeed, Hezekiah's life was given 15-year extension. And the Bible tells us that the next 15 years that Hezekiah spent, he spent it undoing his 14 years legacy. Only if he had died at the end of the first 14 years, he would have died a complete tetelestai death. Live your life to the fullest so that you and none other but can, without any ambiguity and misgiving, present a report as it is demanded of all of us to your Creator or to our Creator. And when we do so, we need to do it in the right format and template that He requires and submit it as tetelestai, it is finished.
Ra leboga re moruti ka mantsoe wa khomotso me re solofela gore le mo malatsing a atlang jaaka re siamisetsa go isa Professor Kgwadi ko lelapeng la gela bofelo lo tla nna lo le teng go thusa ba losika le ditsala go ba khomotsa mo nakong e botlhokoe. At this time, I would like to call upon the Northwest University Choir to render one item, after which I would like to also call to the stage Ella Mukhashwa, Ms. Ella Mukhashwa from the Student Campus Council, to deliver a quick message. Thank you.
Siyabonga ngoba usandiqinile. Ndikhokhele babo sundikho.
A round of applause once again for the Northwest University choir. I've mentioned already that we are running behind schedule, but please allow me to welcome the executive mayor of the Mahikeng local municipality, Councillor Mphetlo. Thank you so much for joining us. At this time, we had also received a request from staff members as well as former colleagues of Prof. Dan to say a few words in remembrance. I would like to first request, as I've mentioned previously, Ms. Ella Mokgaswa from the SCC, Mr. Michael Gant, Prof. Simon Taole, Prof. Helen Drummond, and Prof. Sonia Swanepoel, in that order, to please deliver messages of support. Thank you so much.
Greetings to the House at Large, Kwadi's family, our VC, Honorable Premier of the Northwest, DVC, members of Council, all directors, our pastors, NWU staff members, our community members, and lastly, students, all protocol observed. Let me take this opportunity to express my sincere condolences on behalf of the Mahikeng campus of the Northwest University students. My name is Ella Mokgaswa, the acting chair of the Student Campus Council. My sincerest condolences to the community, the family, friends, and all loved ones. You have the deepest sympathy of students, the unwavering support. In these times, on behalf of the students, would wish you peace, comfort, courage, and lots of love in this time of sorrow. Our hearts goes to everyone in this time. We wish you healing and support. Romans 8:28 reads, "And we know that all that happens to us in working for our good is for God and fitting of his plans." May we all be comforted at this time. Thank you.
Hallelujah. The Northwest University management, the bereaved family, fellow colleagues, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to greet you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Mr. Program Director, I thank you for giving me this opportunity to say a word or two about this fallen soldier, Professor Dan Kwadi. At the Northwest University, we have a staff sports club that is well recognized by the university management. The main objective of the staff sports club is to promote social cohesion, wellness, sports, and recreation. Always the staff is encouraged to participate in various sporting codes. As we all know that sports is good for body and also mental health. The Northwest University Staff Sports Club is a member of the Southern African Universities Staff Sports Association, which is formed by 20 member universities from 8 countries within SADC region. Now, Professor Kwadi was a member in good standing of the Staff Sports Club while he was at the employ of this university. I remember in 2006 when the Northwest University hosted the SAUSA Games, Professor Kwadi played a vital role in influencing his management team at that time to give us all the necessary support to ensure that the Northwest University hosts the best ever SAUSA Games, which they did. Also, I remember the late Professor Kwadi during the SAUSA Games that were hosted by the University of Namibia in 2009. At that time, of his arrival, he actually paid a surprise visit during the games. Now, the netball team had won the semifinals and proceeded to the finals. The players and all of us were motivated by his appearance, and the mood changed completely. Our netball team managed to wallop the University of Botswana in the finals, and they were crowned the champions thereof. As we celebrated the victory of our team, Professor Kwadi and those who were with him joined us in the netball court, singing and dancing there. As if that was good enough, only to find out that there was yet another surprise. He and his team, surprisingly again, arranged dinner for the Northwest University participants at Protea Hotel there in Namibia. Now, I stand here this morning to remember a man with good heart, Professor Kwadi. A man who cared for the wellness and well-being of the staff. A man who always opened his door for the Staff Sports Club to seek any kind of support for its programs. His untimely death came at the time when the Northwest University will be, for the second time since 2006, will be the host of the 22nd edition of SAUSA Games from the 10th until the 15th of December 2023. As I conclude, Program Director, I wish to comfort the bereaved family and all of us that ha siemo sentse jana motso gapele o kileng a tshematshema ka fa morago ga medimo ya nkwemetse o gopola maina a kileng a tabana jaaka bo ga o ngalelwe le bo go itse one le bo re ne re adimilwe. May Cecil and Friede Rus Diabulel.
Mr. Program Director, members of the Kwadi family, the Premier of the Northwest, the Honorable Bushi Maape, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Chobeka, the Campus Rector, Professor Sonipul, members of the university community, pastors, the honorable members of government, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Simeon Taule. Professor Kwadi and I come a long way, and in some respects, I regarded him as my son. It is a fact of life that when you get to a certain age, as I have, you know that the road ahead is shorter than the one behind. Sometimes you imagine that when the day arrives, you are going to have so-and-so to speak, to bid you farewell at your funeral. Little did I know that the opposite would be the case. Indeed, man proposes, but God disposes. It is hardly 6 months ago that Professor Khwadi bid farewell to my sister Nora, who had worked with him. This was the occasion of the passing away of my sister. Today the tables are turned. It is a Taule who bids farewell to Professor Khwadi. There's a saying that goes, grant me the serenity to accept things that I cannot change. Pain and sorrow are intertwined into the everyday fabric of our lives. As parents, we always hope that we will be the first to go to the Father. But we also know that our children are also God's children. And when it is time, He will come and take each one of us to Him. Professor Khwadi's path and mine have crossed a number of times over the years. From the time when he was a student here to the time when he was heading this university. I first knew Professor Khwadi when he was an undergraduate student on this campus, in the days when this was affectionately known as UNIBU. From the early years, I noticed that he was very keen on laboratory practicals, and I developed an interest, maybe a soft spot, for him from that time onwards. I used to be helped in the laboratory by Ntate Pastor Kobosheani, who was a senior technician in the department. And he and I came to the same assessment of the young man's potential and interest. In fact, Ntate Kobosheani used to say of Professor Khwadi, he likes gadgets, he likes toys. After completion of his first degree here, he applied for a scholarship to go to the United States to do his master's. And our paths crossed again then, because I was on the panel that interviewed applicants for the Equal Opportunity Council scholarships. The way the system worked was that the African American Institute, which administered the scholarships, would send an American to South Africa to be on the panels that interviewed applicants in different cities around the country. This campus was one of the venues for the interviews. At the interview, I pointed out to the American panel members who had come to South Africa for the interviews that this particular student, I know, he has potential and deserved to be supported, and he got the scholarship. In the US, he immersed himself in his studies, but also had time for extracurricular activities. Whereas, when he was a student here, his extracurricular activities involved student politics, the SRC, including being involved in student protests against university management in Ohio he took up skydiving. He was a person of great courage. Upon his return from the United States, he became a full-time member of the physics department. He had brought with him educational toys, which he used very effectively in his lectures. In his lectures, there was never a dull moment. Students were attentive, and the results showed in increased pass rate. It was during this time when he was a lecturer here that he intimated to me that as students, they used to think that they could do a better job of running the university, but now he knew better. When he left Mabatu to go and become dean at another university, he left a big gap which was difficult to fill. And Professor Khadina Bukau and I felt the loss. He did not stay very long in Vaal. He left after a few years to join the National Nuclear Regulator, which is an SOE, a state-owned enterprise. When he applied for the job for senior manager at the NNR, I was one of the directors on the board of the NNR, and I became a member of the panel that interviewed him. In this way, his path in life and mine crossed again. His stay at the NNR exposed him to how SOEs operate, and this came in very handy because when we returned to the university, we were busy negotiating with other SOEs like NEXA and the NAC for the establishment of the Center for Applied Radiation Science and Technology, CAST. When you are negotiating with someone, it helps to know where they come from. The corporate world of SOEs did not hold on to him very long. A vacancy appeared at this campus for a campus rector, and Professor Khwadi applied. Once again, I submitted a very strong motivation for his appointment, and he got the job. I believe that when he arrived here, he had had a very good preparation for the job. He had been a student here and had been involved in student politics. So he had that understanding of students. He had been a junior lecturer here and understood the challenges which they face. He had been head of department and had successfully supervised postgraduate students. He had also been a dean of a faculty at another university. I believe all that preparation was put in good use as he navigated the potholes of being a rector on this campus. Professor Khwadi's stay as a rector of the Mabatu campus was marked by a massive infrastructure expansion, which I thought was a great achievement for him. I actually pointed out this to him as a compliment. But in his mind, he rated the fact that he had been able to contain possible conflict with the student body as his greater achievement. It helped that he had once been on the other side. It was also during his early years as campus principal here that the demographics of student population diversified considerably. He was a man of strong conviction and moral courage. He stated what he believed in and fought hard for his convictions. He was a driven man, driven by the desire to improve the lot of his fellow countrymen. If he had been driven by the desire to accumulate personal wealth, he would not have left the SOE. He would not have come back to the university and to academia. His was a higher calling. He never forgot his roots, nor those who had helped him. He never forgot that this campus was built with contributions from ordinary citizens and therefore was unique in this way. I recall that before he left Mabato to go and be Vice Chancellor of Northwest University, he used to invite retired professors and senior academics twice a year to a get together so that they can keep in touch with developments here and perhaps continue to make a contribution to this campus. He clearly not only appreciated the creativity, enthusiasm, and energy of youth, he also respected the experience and wisdom of elders. Professor Khwadi made good use of the talents he was given. He made good use of the opportunities that he was given. His life's work should be an inspiration to students. Be challenged by what he achieved in his life. Be challenged to think beyond your surroundings. Be challenged to reach for the sky as he did. Although to the Khwadi family and to all those who loved him, the wish is that he could have been given more days and lived a lot longer. The fact is that Professor Khwadi had run his race. He had kept the faith. Excuse me. We have to accept this and learn to say, Hulukile. I wish to convey my sincere condolences to the Khwadi family in the first place, but his passing is also a great loss to the province and to the university committee, this university. My condolences, therefore, also go to them. May the God of grace comfort you, family, and all those who feel the loss. May his soul rest in eternal peace. Amen.
Good afternoon to everyone who is gathered here today. I'm not going to go through names again, all protocol observed, but I do recognize the VC and the Premier. I arrived at the University of Maputo Tswana in 1985, and soon after that, I came across Dan Khwadi as a student in my chemistry classes. So I think I was one of the first, together with a couple of my colleagues here, to meet him then. Later, he came back to the Mafikeng campus as a physics lecturer after he had got an MSc degree in the States. And then later, his PhD degree was in physics education, which is a field that very strongly overlaps with my own field, which is chemical education. And in fact, he got that degree at what was then the University of Potchefstroom, and his supervisor there was my external examiner when I did my PhD, Prof. Jan Smit, who I think a lot of us remember very dearly. I then worked with Prof. Dan, firstly as a lecturer, then as campus rector, and later as vice chancellor. Prof. Dan was always respectful towards those of us who taught him. Even as he rose to higher levels than us, he would sometimes phone us to ask for our advice. I know that he did that to me, and I believe some of the others as well. He always said that if he performed well, then it was due to the good teaching and good example that he received from me and colleagues such as Prof. Simeon Taole, Prof. Khadina Bukau, Prof. David Isaberia. On the other hand, he also joked that if he did anything wrong, well, then it was our fault rather than his, that we hadn't done a good enough job. So I'm going to leave you to be the judge as to whether we did a good job or not. So I think that I can also add at this stage that Prof. Dan was not the only VC that I taught. I've also taught Prof. Bismarck Chebeka. He was also my student. So continue to judge, did I do a good job or did I not? So I have taught two vice chancellors, but I did not expect one of them to leave us so soon. And so on behalf of the university, but particularly the faculty, which is now called Natural and Agricultural Sciences, formerly on this campus it was FAST, Agriculture, Science and Technology, of which Prof. Dan was a part, I extend heartfelt condolences to the Kwadi family, and may his soul rest in peace. I thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, to our honorable guests, all protocol observed, to the family, specifically of Fancy, colleagues, friends, and students. Dumelang Baga Etsu. Yeah, it is with a heavy heart I share with you some vivid memories. Prof. Dan, and somehow his passing is still unreal to me and to most of you. So last night I thought, where will I begin? So I thought, since my appointment as executive dean, and it was then the Faculty of Commerce and Administration on this campus in 2010, my journey with Prof. Dan commenced. He was then the campus rector since 1 January 2005, and then in April 2014, until January 2022, the VC of NWU. He had such a passion for students, and I remember him visiting residences, which I accompanied him in, and he touched base with students. And he wanted to keep his finger on the pulse and his ear to the ground to understand the plight and challenges of students. At one of these meetings, he explained that being poor is not a reason to commit any form of violence or criminal activity, and it should actually motivate students to utilize education to improve their circumstances. And then at the annual meeting, remember we used to have on Sundays the meetings with the parents, those of you can remember that. He explained that although our tuition fees are low, we do not offer cheap education, but quality education at a cheap price. He also warned students and parents that we do not tolerate any form of violent behavior at this NWU, and that you will go to the gate if students commit any such. He assured students and parents that we will provide a safe haven to all our students on campus. But he also created a conducive environment for staff to develop and grow. I remember as campus rector, Prof. Eleni will still teach Physics 1. And how did he manage that? Because he felt so passionate, and therefore he walked in the shoes of academics. Under his leadership, many young academics reached professorial level, and excellence in academia was never negotiable in his books. He valued diversity on all campuses and was passionate about transformation in totality, staff, curriculum, etc. His leadership skills of motivation, providing a shared vision that he eloquently communicated, transparency and integrity that he displayed is how we will remember him. In conclusion, I thought I want to share a poem with you, and it's by an unknown author. It's called Let Me Go. When I come to the end of the road and the sun has set for me, I want no rights in a gloom-filled room. Why cry for a soul set free? Miss me a little, but not for long, and not with your head bowed low. Remember the love that once we shared. Miss me, but let me go. For this is a journey we all must take, and each must go alone. It's all part of the master plan, a step on the road to home. When you are lonely and sick at heart, go to the friends we know. Laugh at all the things we used to do. Miss me, but let me go. As Psalm 34 verse 18 reads, the Lord is close to those whose hearts have been broken. He saves those whose spirits have been crushed. Dear Prof. Dan, rest in peace. Thank you. Kia ora, Prof.
Thank you once again to former and current colleagues of Prof. Dan, who have painted a picture of the man that we are celebrating today. Indeed, death is never easy. Kole lapeng ditsala le balosika re kopa gore tswetswe re solofela gore modimo o tla lothusa o tla tsidia tsa di painitse le leng mo go tsone. Me kwa bokhutlong jwa tsotlhe lo tla amogela se se diragetseng. Loso ke la rona rotlhe. We'll shortly screen a slideshow, after which I will give over to our VC, Prof. Bismarck Chobeka, Ntate Tiego Khomu, as well as the Honorable Premier of the Northwest Province, Re Bushimape, to also say a few words.
Happy. Peter, I'll always love you. Thank you.
Re Moradisi, ya go leboga ka tshono e o mphileng yona gore ke tle go latlhelela motlapitsong. Re Kgomo, modulasetulo wa khansele, ke ra leloko la khansele ya Yunibesithi ya Bokone Bophirima. Mopremieri wa rona Re Mape, meyara wa rona wa Mahikeng, maloko wa tsamaiso ya Yunibesithi ya Bokone Bophirima ba ba leng teng ha, baeteledipele ba maloba ba Yunibesithi ya rona jaaka bo professorara Malope, bo professorara Taole, jalo le jalo. Ba dira ka nna mo tsamaisong ya yunibesithi, badiredi ba yunibesithi le baithuti ba losika lo rakgwadi ba gaetsho. Dumela. It is with great sadness that I stand before you to pay tribute to a true humanitarian, Professor Daniel Kgwadi, a dear friend and mentor whom I had the privilege of knowing for almost 30 years and had the honor of working closely with him for 10 years. As Prof. Helen has said earlier, Prof. Dan was my physics lecturer during my student days way back in 1994. Then we moved on to the time when I was the chairperson of council, and then recently as a fellow vice chancellor and a colleague in the sector. When I was asked to speak at this service today, I pondered what would be the best way to start my tribute to Prof. Dan. I remembered that Prof. Dan was a Christian and an Adventist. And so, the Holy Book provided immediate refuge to me. In deciding which book to read from, and in view of the trials and tribulations that he went through in his career lately, I was reminded that we just came from Passover. And so, I settled for the book of John chapter 19. Mfundisi, this is a coincidence. Trust me. I settled for the book of John chapter 19, verses 1 to 5. And it reads as follows. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers also twisted together a crown of thorns and placed it on his head. Then they threw a robe around him. They kept coming to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they kept hitting him in the face. Pilate went outside again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." Now, my learned friend in the theologian community, Professor Balia, is here. "Behold the man," they convinced me that it was translated from Latin. Ichi homo. Ichi homo. Behold the man. Now, in my Xhosa language, Abafundis have a way of putting it. And simply, they say, "Ngumntu lo." Now, for those of you who may have the anxiety that I'm about to preach, I'm not going to preach. By God's grace and by God's will, it turns out that the pastor and me had a visit from the angels last night and decided on the same scripture. And of course, God decided that he was going to do the task of preaching. And therefore, I leave you with that. Behold the man. Ngumntu lo. As we mourn the loss of this remarkable man, I would like to express my deepest sympathies to all of you who knew him well, especially his family members. Prof. Kwadi, as we've heard, was a very compassionate and empathetic individual. He always took time to listen to the stories and struggles of others and offered a kind word or a helping hand whenever possible. It would take the whole day if I were to narrate to you the stories that he shared with me about how he helped people that he never knew, and how in some cases the same people turned against him. Throughout his life, Prof. Kwadi made it his mission to give back to those in need, both in his community and at the university. He recognized the importance of helping others and took action to make a positive impact in the world. Whether it was through his charitable giving, providing support for students, or inspiring young people, Prof. Dan touched the lives of countless individuals and communities. He was known for his kindness and generosity, always going above and beyond to help those that were less fortunate. He believed in the power of education and worked very tirelessly to provide educational opportunities to young people, regardless of their backgrounds. He also recognized the importance of providing access to higher education and contributed to the acceleration of the transformation agenda. His unwavering commitment to social justice was evident in all his activities, both professionally and personally. His legacy will live on through the countless lives he touched and the positive impact he had in the world. His selfless dedication to helping others serves as an inspiration to all of us and will continue to motivate us to make a difference in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I had the honor of being a part of the farewell that the university did for him when he left for the Valley University of Technology. That occasion gave us an opportunity to give him flowers when he was still alive. And he appreciated that greatly. Although we were sad when he left, on hindsight, God was saying to us, celebrate this man while he is still alive. He knew how we felt about him, and we knew how he felt about us. In my time as the chairman of council, we had similar moments where we celebrated many, many wins. I must say that these wins did not come easy, as we had to go through a robust and uncomfortable process to shape the strategic direction of the Northwest University. His handling of uncomfortable conversations and events of divergent views during this process was commendable. He was someone who would listen and analyze issues before making comments. Even when he made comments, they were always conciliatory and aimed at bringing all the parties together. His personality and approach brought stability to the university, and he was indeed the leader that the Northwest University needed at that time. He was an outspoken and at times a very provocative person. Those who know him as a friend on Facebook would attest to this. I remember one occasion which was controversial, about the removal of Lingau, just outside here. Then knew that that was a very difficult discussion at council. I was one of the people who said, no, don't remove it. Now, Dan was never a political person. He was completely apolitical. And therefore, the way he advanced the argument brought a lot of balance and sanity in the discussion. But then he went on and posted that on Facebook. And I was sitting at home on a Friday evening, and I was going through Facebook, and I saw these comments lashing at him, people who graduated from this campus. Why would you do that? Why would you remove the only symbol we're left with? So I took out my phone and called him. VC, what are you doing? He said, no, bring them on. Let them vent out. He said, because this is a dialogue that we have avoided for so many years, the time has come for us to talk about it. And I can assure you, many of the people that were unhappy, he made sure to go through every comment and reply. And I'm sure I'm talking more than 300 comments on that particular post, and replied to each and every one of them to ensure that we are all on the same page. So, I would like to express my deepest condolences to all of you during this difficult time. To Ufense and Kopano, be comforted and strengthened in this difficult and trying times. Your father and grandfather loved you so much while he was alive. And it was evident to all of us that you were very dear to his heart. With that in mind, I thought I must read you the poem which I found very apt for Prof. Dan's send-off. The poem was composed by Alfred Lord Tennyson in response to the death of his friend Arthur Henry Hallam. But in my imagination, I imagine that as Prof. Dan rested in that hospital bed, he silently recited this poem to all his friends, his colleagues of many years, his family, and above all, his daughter and grandson. The title of the poem is Ulysses, and it goes like this. It little profits that an idle king by this still hath among these barren crags, matched with an aged wife I meet and dole, an equal loss unto a savage race that hoard and sleep and feed and know not me. I cannot rest from my travel, I will drink life to the lees, and all times I have enjoyed greatly, have suffered greatly, both with those that loved me and alone, on shore, and when through scudding drifts the rainy haze vexed the dim sea, I am become a name. For always roaming with a hungry heart, much have I seen and known cities of men and manners, climates, councils, governments, myself not least, but honored of them all, and drunk delight of battle with my peers, far on the ringing plains of windy Troy, I am a part of all that I have met. Yet all experience is an arc wherethrough, glimpse that untraveled world whose margin fades forever and forever when I move. How dull it is to pause, to make an end, to rust unburnished, not to shine in use, as though to breathe where life piled on life, where all too little and of one to me. Little remains, but every hour is saved. From that eternal silence, something more, a bringer of new things, and while it were. For some three suns to store and hoard myself, to follow knowledge like a sinking star beyond the utmost bound of human thought. This is my son, my own Telemachus, to whom I leave the scepter and the isle, well loved of me, discerning to fulfill this labor by slow prudence to make mild a rugged people, and through soft degrees subdue them to the useful and the good. Most blameless is he, centered in the sphere of common duties, decent not to fail, in offices of tenderness and pay, meet adoration to my household gods. When I'm gone, he works his work, and I mine. There lies the port, the vessel puffs her sail. There gloom the dark, broad seas. My mariners, souls that have toiled and wrought and thought me, that ever with a frolic welcome took the thunder and the sunshine and opposed. Free hearts, free foreheads, you and I are old. Old age, yet his honor and his toil. Death closes all, but something ere the end, some work of noble note may yet to be done. Not unbecoming men that strove with the gods. The long day wanes, the slow moon climbs, the deep moans round with many voices. Come, my friends, 'tis not too late to seek a newer world. Push off and sitting well in order to smite the sounding furrows for my purpose holds, to sail beyond the sunset and the baths of all western stars until I die. It may be that the gulfs will wash us down. It may be we shall touch the happy isles and see the great Achilles whom I knew. Though much is taken, much abides. And though we are not now that strength which in old days moved earth and heaven, that which we are. One equal temper of heroic hearts, made weak by time and fate, but strong in will, to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. Behold the men. Rest in peace, Prof. Den.
They would like to say something.
To the Premier of the province, Majoro wa rona wa Mahikeng, the Principal and Vice Chancellor of NWU, Professor Bismarck Jobeka, also allow me to single a few that I've seen here. Kebone, my former Vice Chancellor, Professor Milato Malupe. I've also seen Professor Lesole Khadina Bokao, and I've also seen Professor Taole. And those of you, Bakisawawanang, please pardon me, all protocol observed. Let me also take this opportunity to also recognize the family and the DVC of this campus, being Mahikeng campus. I am representing the Northwest University Council, having been requested by the chairperson and the deputy chairperson of council, Mr. Bert Sovrages and Mr. Obake Mungale. Being a pastor, I think it will be very important that I also quote from the big Bible, the big book. From Isaiah 66, verse 13, which says, as one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you, and you shall be comforted. God heals the brokenhearted and bandages their wounds. Psalms 147, verse 3. And lastly, the Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. And that is Psalms 145, verse 3. Having to talk about Prof. Then, it's not an easy fit for me. I studied with him. I met him in 1988. Little did I know that our paths will cross on later when I had to become a council member in 2013. Dan's task as a vice chancellor was not an easy one. And I think Professor Bismarck Jobeka, as the third chairperson of council at that time, would recall that our agenda, it was not a normal agenda, especially in meetings, because our main focus and task was to deal with issues of transformation. And now his task was to make sure that back then we had University of Northwest, we had University of Potchefstroom, and we also had University of Vaal. Now all these federal institutions had to become one, and that being Northwest University. And you could imagine the task ahead of council to make sure that whatever that we decide, then has to implement. It was not an easy thing for any VC to do at that point in time. And I always felt that he has a lot of work to do. And I remember there were times where even our meetings in council, you know, we had to ask for adjournments because not all of us were singing from the same hymn book. And it was because there were people who felt that we are taking away something from them that they had to defend. And we also felt that there is something that we want to be done to benefit all the students and staff of the institution. But eyes cannot see the same, neither can ear, your ears hear the same. And because of that, you know, there had to be those robust engagements. But in the end, when we had decided as council, then it was the responsibility of management through Professor Dan to implement the decisions of council. And one thing about Prof. Dan which I liked is that he was fearless, very, very fearless. You know, he knew that there were people who didn't like him because of implementing the decisions of council. Yet he went ahead and implemented them. There were times where I even feared for his life, especially staying in Potchefstroom, you know, where I would constantly ask him, are you safe? Are you okay? Is everything fine? And to a point where, you know, he had to convince us that, look, maybe it's fine for me if people don't know my physical address for my own safety. And we had to oblige as council to say that for your own safety, if you see that that will work for you, let it be. And it went on like that to a point where, you know, he had to leave the institution. But one thing I also need to point out is that we are talking of someone who is completely against fraud and corruption. If there's one thing about Dan, anybody can accuse him of anything else, but never about fraud or corruption. Never. You know, his interests, number one was students, two was staff, and then three, obviously, you know, it would be other stakeholders. And let me tell you that this particular campus was very, very close to his heart. Very, very close. And that is why even when there were strikes on this campus, he would leave everything and come driving to Mahikeng. I remember at one instance I said to him, please be careful. Especially now, you know, when you see flames and fire and, you know, you're thinking that this is someone now who's going right inside the thick of things. And he said, look, this is what I'm called to do. And I have no one to send. I have to go there and do the work. Dan carried out his mandate as given by council to the call. And funny enough, we are talking of someone, you know, who was very, very selfless. Dan was very, very selfless. Dan was humble and so full of respect. If there is any council member who would say that Dan never bestowed that respect to him or her, I would really be surprised. Because he respected council members, and it was funny because both internal and external. You know, at times you think that because you are internal and internal, you have to respect to report to him as the VC. It would make a difference, but let me tell you, he respected council members, both internal and external. Dan was very compassionate about everything that he had to do. And one thing about him also is that, you know, Dan admired any peaceful gathering or peaceful situation. And the other time I asked him, you know, you have really changed a bit. Unfortunately, I cannot tell you about our time as students because I'm representing council. Otherwise, you'll be in stitches. And I have to be confined to council and not our student days. Otherwise, I'm telling you, you'll ask yourself, is it the same Prof. Dan that we are talking about? But yeah, you know, I remember in Potchefstroom during his farewell, I think on the slides, it was almost towards the end, where I think there was a quartet that was singing. And that song was saying, time to say goodbye. And if you listen to his speech, he was indeed bidding us farewell. And the funny part is that his contract, thank you, sir. Whew, I thought I'm strong. The funny part is that his contract was due to end in 2025 with this institution. And he chose to leave, and I had a discussion with him, and I asked him, VC, why they need to leave? And he said to me, Brur, I think I've done everything which I had to do in this institution. Anyone who's got to come and be a captain, I think he will find this vessel just, you know, sailing smoothly. Yes, there might be hiccups there and there, but look, the greatest hurdles we have jumped And we have achieved what we set to achieve. And I'm happy about our program as an institution to this extent. Little did one know that the new challenges that you are looking forward to will ultimately you'd understand that as people, we have our plans, and you know, each time we're thinking of tomorrow, we're thinking of next week, next month, and next year. The unfortunate part, though, is that little did we know that as we plan, there is a master planner. And if you read Isaiah chapter number 55, verses 8 and 9, it says, "Your plans are not my plans, neither are your ways my ways, for my plans and my ways are always higher than your plans and than your ways." We had plans even with Dan, and we had plans as a family. You know, there were plans around Dan, and Dan also had plans. But little did we know that such plans will be cut so soon and too short. To the family, I would like to say, the Lord will fight for you, and you should hold your peace. And that is the scripture in Exodus chapter 14, verses 14. And I say again to the family that you are not the only ones who have lost. I believe that everybody here and those online, if they had something to say about Prof. Dan, they will definitely be saying their bit. And lastly, let me just say that may his soul rest in peace and rise in glory at the second coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Tetelestai, it is finished.
Raleboga Rekhomo, thank you very much, VC, for the kind words about Braden. We were requested to also give an opportunity to the anointed armor of God gospel choir Horopela sengwenyana ke nkere pele ga ke fa re mape tshono ya go bua sengwe banne ba ikatimetse me mo se bakeng sa janong ba gaitso ga se re tle mo phithlong ke kopa ka tswetse gore re tle re tlhabeletse ha re ka ema energy ya nna ya tsena ga nyane ka tswetse ke leboga re mrute
Ikolo la mengo nyukana lo la mengo nyukana lo ulibambe esanda giyongena nalo ekhaye ikolo la mengo nyukana lo
ikolo la mengo
nyukana lo ulibambe ngesa No makuzima, no makuzima, no makuyenuka, ukolo la meni ogena nalo, ekaya sulene. No makuzima, no makuzima, no. Ukolo la meni ogena nalo.
Yeah. Ke a leboga thata ba gaitso ba tshwareng ka matsogo ra leboga Arm of God Gospel Choir. We are almost at the end of the program, but before we do that, we need to give an opportunity to our Premier, Ntate Bushi Maape, to say a few words, after which I will invite Ntate Lester Mpolokeng, manager in the DVC's office, who will also make an announcement. He will actually do the vote of thanks, as well as an announcement on behalf of the family. Thank you so much.
Program Director, the family of Professor Dan Kwadi, Vice Chancellor Professor Bismarck Chobeka, members of the University Council present here today, members of the Executive Council of the Northwest, if they are present here today, Executive Mayor of Mafikeng Local Municipality. I don't know whether in academia we have veterans, but to all veteran professors, the Student Representative Council, the Kositarona Ifdili Temfano, leaders of different faith-based organizations, esteemed ladies and gentlemen, Dumelang Bagaetsho. Before I go to my prepared text, let me just make these comments that I feel a little bit disadvantaged and disempowered. We were seated there listening. I could clearly make out that people who came here before me knew the prof more than I did. And again, I was set up so that I must be the last speaker, so that they said everything that was there to be said about him. Be that as it may, I must acknowledge that I really had limited encounters with Professor Dan Kwadi. But I must also say that those occasions were sufficient for me to form an opinion of him. And this is what I would like to share with you. Sharing this with you, paying tribute to him, and hoping that at the same time I'll contribute towards soothing the aching hearts of those who were very intimate, close to him, be family, be co-workers, be others in society. Indeed, it is a singular honor for me to be afforded an opportunity to make a few remarks here today at this solemn occasion when we bid Professor Dan Kwadi the final farewell. On behalf of the government and the people of the Northwest, we want to start by conveying our heartfelt condolences to the family, friends, and colleagues of Professor Dan Kwadi. We further wish to extend our sympathies to the community of the Valley University of Technology and the Northwest University Academia, administrators, students, and workers. We, as the province of the Northwest, are poorer with the passing of an academic giant of the stature of Professor Dan Kwadi. Northwest and the country have lost an academic who was unflinching in his support for academic excellence, particularly among poor and previously disadvantaged students. We are greatly honored and proud for the fact that we have associated with Professor Kwadi in several ways. Kingonoambu, born and bred here in the Northwest, he acquired his first degree at this university. He later in life, as you have heard, taught at this university. He ascended to the apex position when he was inaugurated as principal of his alma mater. He came from humble beginnings, as we've been told, but with dedication, tenacity, and fortitude, conquered impediments which are always a serious challenge for the black child. And through this journey, he acquired a master's degree abroad, and he became a PhD, thanks to the United Nations scholarship. His was a journey of outstanding performance and remarkable achievements. What is also worth noting is the choice he made in terms of the field of study he pursued. We were old, we'll recall how the apartheid architect Hendrik Verwoerd proclaimed what was to be the station in life of a black child. And I quote him, "What is the use teaching a Bantu child mathematics when it cannot use it in practice? What is the use teaching a Bantu child mathematics when it cannot use it in practice?" But Prof. Kwadi turned this cruel assertion on its head by showing lofty aptitude and an insatiable appetite for the sciences. Bagaetsho, re utlwile how Professor Kwadi displayed a deep commitment to academic excellence and community service. This was aptly demonstrated by the mentorship programs he initiated, career exhibition activities he arranged, and support to those who wish to further their academic careers. At Unatlisa University, Kokrai Panele Kumahayenkwa, but Wawanahonali University. The government of the Northwest signed a memorandum of understanding with the Northwest University in order to structure our cooperation between ourselves and the university. And this initiative was the brainchild of Professor Job Mokoro, who was then Premier of the Northwest, and Professor Dan Kwadi, who was at the time Principal of the Northwest University. And so we could name this MOU the Two Professors MOU. This MOU entails a myriad of activities, projects, and programs. And we are very pleased. We are very pleased and excited that we are already harvesting the benefits of this relationship. There's no time and space for me to start listing those programs. I mean, we talk all the time with the prof. You know, I'm sure he's going to give me an honorary doctorate. But we have these programs, very helpful, very meaningful. Bagaetsho, we launched the Victor Tebe Sefora Bursary Scheme here in this hall. And we expended an amount of 21.1 million to support students from previously disadvantaged families whose parents cannot afford costs of university education. And I must say, the majority of those students are from this university. The intervention assisted students with tuition fees, accommodation cost, and living expenses. Another amount of 1.7 million was utilized to redeem the debts of those students who could not graduate or proceed to the next class because they owed the university money. I did have a discussion with the deputy VC there about this problem, but we are trying to do something about it because we will forever intensify our efforts to ensure that we make our little contribution towards making free tertiary education a reality for the black child. And the Victor Sefora Bursary Scheme is intended for that. As the provincial government will continue to honor Professor Dan Kwadi's legacy, particularly in relation to assistance that must be provided to students, We want to make sure that they pursue their studies without financial impediments. I know this is a big ask. I know this is a huge task, but we want to make this commitment as the university. This will be our contribution to the legacy of Professor Dan Kwadi. We will further entrench and fortify our collaboration with the Northwest University. This will do in pursuance of the ideals and ideas Professor Dan Kwadi gave to and nurtured. May his soul rest in eternal peace. I thank you.
Re kopa ao katla wa tla go ira announcement on behalf of the family. Re tle re itse gore dithulaganyo tsa bokhutlo jwa beke bo di tsamayang.
Ke a leboga re motsamaisa tiro. O ka mpakela gore ga ke a bidiwa ke italeditse hela ke lomirilwe ke mangwe mo apelo ka kgalebo ke dirile ba bokwa wena o tlolwa ntate Dan Kwadi tswaelo ditiro wa di dira di a bonwa. Ke emisa re Mpolokeng mme ke mo emisa ka go lo tlhalosetsa ntate Dan Kwadi. O tlolore lo molatole sentle. Ntate Dan Kwadi ke motho wa ga modimo wa motho yo. Ke modimo o bobowa, modimo wa dikgosi, motho wa ga bogosi ga botlolo e se letsoko, bogosi ga bo moganong e se loleme, bogosi ga bo moganong e se meno, bogosi bo mo madimo bo a tsalelwa. Ke motho wa ga mogakajane molela sebebe nong e kgolo rang kabite ga e gona ya go tlhapa e tsena ka maoto le mahuba. Motho yo ke setlogolo se o tabayo, ke setlogolo sa ga Kwadi, setlogolo sa ga Kobo Kwadi Thamagana mmala yone o nkgaditshwang rona le nna ke re Matebele re nyala ka bomo re Matebele. Ke setlogolo sa ga horohoro o dintsi-dintsi di kile tsa tsena ka kolomela tsa ba tsa tsena ka kgoro ya sebonoko go taba amaleho. Ke a imelwa, ke imelesega ke pelo, ke ne ke ratile go lore ga legoko lengwe le nkgakile ga le a nkgaka ke boa ka lone.
Protocol observed. Ke emela go kgwatla ka tlhaa ke ntshe morabaraba wa loleme ka dipounama. Ke bue ka Rre Kwadi Mina Tholo Tshipientsho ya Noto, morutabana kgotsa teachere. Mogalagala o re fatlhositseng wa re rola thoko wa re ntsha bobi mathong. Motlhantlha kwa tlharapa le leleele se ka toga monyomo kolobetsa dikgato monyomo ga sama ka meso. E tle re ga ke bua ka motho a nthutile jaana ebile ke rwele dipurapura tsa BNSC Bachelor of Nursing Science. Leleme la me letle lesise se ka kgomo ya mašwi gore ke thatologe jaaka tlatlaloselo kgotsa moseme o logilwe ka segagalele kosa ke gate ka maoto be di go sala mekhotlhotlho bo ja matuba kwa khomo e phatswa robala ka kagiso mo palami wa setlhwa sa thuto robala ka kagiso naledi mo seswa ga mangkhothi maronthotho e ka re re ka itaganya le lemele magalapa go mo akgola
ke a leboga mme boe ke leboge malome kgwadi-kgwadi ka go nkemisa ka leboko lo borrakgwadi Mr. Vice Chancellor sir, the Premier, the executive, mayors for Mahikeng and Zwaying, the leadership of the church, university community, and the congregation at large, Dumelang. Ha sa le pigitswile ha batho ba founa kana ba romela melaetsa pele ba ipotsa ba re ke ikutlwa jang mme ga se nna fela ke potso e tlang mo balolapa ha ke tsa kgang ya monna o tshwengwang ke loto o tla ba ya bookelong mme a fitlha bookelong di-nurse ba tla 'ira se ba tshwantseng go ka se 'ira gongwe letsatsi morago ba mo ise theatre a nne le gone go ka diro karo after a successful operation he'll be taken back to the ward to go and recover the challenge the person would be facing now is to plan life without part of his body Not only that, now you must revise all the plans that you have made so that they suit the condition that you are in now. You must start to learn how to walk with one foot, probably with the assistance of crutches. As a family, we are at that particular stage. Relatlhegetswe ke a pillar of the family. Came if I've lost a twin brother. We are making adjustments to face life without this pillar. It will be tough, but with the assistance and the support we've been receiving ever since day one, the Lord will provide. Re latlhegetswe re a itse gore ga se rona fela. Go nneng ga lona fa go a re bontsha gore ntate kgwadi ga mannete e ne le motho wa batho re rata go tsaya tshone vice chancellor re le morago ga ntate kgwadi a fetsa go tswa mo setheong ga iseng ke lo re latlhe staff of your institution have always availed their services and support to him Even when he was very sick, he'd always comment about the support that he would get, it would be from the Northwest University. He was stronger because of this institution. Re lebogela thotloetso e yo
yotlhe e re boneng go tswa go kerekeng baagi ba bokone bophirima. Ntate Kgwadi e ne e le motho o ratang thuto. Gantsi ga na bua le baithuti. He was raised by a single parent who was a principal of a primary school. And he'd always say, a principal of a primary school in a village managed to raise a principal of a university. To the students, like all the eloquent speakers have said here, let's make education our priority. Let's take that and make a change in our families. Let's go and bring a change in the community from where we come from. Ntate Kgwadi re tla mmaya ka Sontaga, the 7th of May, ko Mofufutso. Space request. Phitlho e tla simolola ka ura ya bosupa, 7 o'clock. I think he wanted also for people to see what he has done. He has turned a village and made it a lively place to be at. He has built a lodge with the only swimming pool in that particular area, which is open to the community. Kosi o na tsweletse go aga a hall because there's none within the area for the community to make use of. And currently there's a gym also in that particular area which he has established for the community. Those are just part of the few things that Ntate Kgwadi did for the community. At this particular time, probably I'll just introduce Dan's siblings. Kikope Ausmeshia Hokaema, who was the firstborn of Sheila, the principal. Ntate Kgwadi was the second born, and he was followed by Conrad Kgwadi, the last born being Tsireletso. He was blessed by a beautiful daughter, Ofentse Babi Kgwadi. Babi ke kopela o ka ema ba go itse. Kopano ga ke mone o dule fa. Is the grand child ya ga Dan o na mmitsa Madala. In most posts, utlabona kopano a fichara, if it's not Ofentse, who was his father's friend, ene ele Madala aling fo. Wakhen hakitsu rumo kai utengfa, lene kubona la dule, wakhen it's one of the sons that then raised as his own. Kitlo kopa borre, Borra Kgwadi le Borra Kwena More gore ba eme phuthego e kgone go bona gore lo gone fa lotlileng. Borra Kgwadi le Borra Kwena More. VC, this is the delegation that came for the memorial service. We wanted to send a smaller delegation, and due to the role that the university and the province have played Mobutsilong Baganta Dekwadi, they felt that the whole family would come and honor this particular occasion. To offer us the Great Hall and this opportunity. We thank everybody that has spoken here. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've now come to the end of the program. Mo sebakeng sa jaanong se se setseng fela ke go leboga re leboga Vice Chancellor rona Rebus Mark Chobeka go tla re leboga Re Mape re leboga Re Khomo wa Khansele re leboga le the leadership academic and support staff le lona ba gaetso ba ba tswang gaufi le kgakala ba ba tleng ba bona gone go le matshwanedi gore ba tle go gomotsa ba lelapa mme mo go ba lelapa re ntse re re jaaka le tlabe le ba re kgwadi mo letsatsing la Sontaga tsholofelo ke gore lo tla kgona go dira sentle mme gantsi ga go nna le ditiro tse di tshwanang le tse re atle re dirise tshono go ka kgala bogolosegolo bašwa ka gonne o fitlhela ko diphitlhong gantsi ko mabitleng ga batho ba tshwanetse ba ya go thusa ko mabitleng o bo fitlhela batho ba butse dibutu batho ba noa dilo tse ke sa batleng go bua maina tsone rotlhe re a itse gore ke bua ka eng jaanong ka tswetswe a re tlhompeng ditiro tsa batho ba bangwe a re tsamaise ntate Prof Dan Kgwadi ka the respect e a na e tshwanetse e mo tshwanetseng mme mo sebakeng sa jaanong bangwe ba rona ba batlabeng ba ya kwa phitlhong a re tsamaye sentle a re seka ranwa re seka ra tsamaya re itshela mme a re gorogeng re phela mme kwa bokhutlong ke kopa go leboga lotlhe fela ka go tla kwano mme ke kopa go kopa Pastor Tima Seko gore tswalela tiro ya gompieno ke a leboga bagaetsho.
Are rappeling, shall we pray? Our most gracious, kind and loving Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you for the time well spent in this place. We are grateful, Father, that we could be part of this beautiful program. And Lord, we thank you that we could not only come to mourn the death of a great man, but Lord, to celebrate a life well lived. And Lord, as we come to the end of this program, we want to, in a special way, present the family of this great man to your care. Only you can take care of them, Father. We present his children, that you comfort them. We know that they are going through a very trying time at this very moment. But I pray, Lord, that you may bless them, Father, with the comfort of your love. Comfort his friends, comfort his loved ones, comfort his colleagues and all that were affected by his death. And at the end of it all, Lord, I also pray that you may bless every man and woman who took part and made sure that this program becomes a great success. This is our prayer in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.